Thank you, Hugues, for this very passionate and super interesting introduction. So I have one good news and one bad news. The good news is that I'm going to talk about open hardware for the next 40 minutes to you, and I'm super excited about it. The bad news is that you're going to have to support my terrible accent during 1 hour, so I wish you the best of luck with that. So just a few words about me. So my name is Benjamin. I'm from the north of France, but I live in Paris. I'm the co-founder of an organization called WeShare, which is a non-profit think tank community around the peer-to-peer and collaborative society. I'm also working on a project regarding open hardware and sustainability, which I'm going to introduce a bit later in the presentation. And I'm especially interested in the fields of distributed fabrication and open hardware, and actually I'm right now doing some preparation to start a PhD on that topic next year. I'm going to divide the time I have into five parts, and then we'll have a short discussion. So first I'm going to put a bit of open hardware into context of distributed fabrication and maker movement, then focus more on the local distributed aspect and the supply chains, talk a bit about how entrepreneurs and companies are making business in this field of open hardware, talk a bit about the economic models, and maybe conclude with a few reasons why open hardware is really important, even though Hugues has already mentioned a few of those already. So I don't need to introduce you what open hardware is. I think that most people in the room are familiar, but like, just so you know, this is an official definition from the Open Source Hardware Association, which was founded a bit more than 1 year ago in the US. So it's basically tangible artifacts with design and digital files you can make, modify, distribute, and use for whichever use you want. And it has applications in many fields, many spaces, electronics, machine tools, biology, architecture, furniture, and so on. You've probably seen a few of these projects already. I'm going to mention a few of them later in the presentation. But so maybe to put that into broader context, we need to talk very briefly about the maker movement and the concept of distributed production. I really like putting these two pictures side to side because it shows basically that, okay, making things or the maker movement or whatever we want to call it, DIY, is not in fact a new thing. We've had even this kind of magazine, so it's for like, it's from 1949, a Mécanique Populaire, and this were this kind of magazine in which you had tutorials and know-hows and how to build yourself this SOS transmitter and many other products. So basically, when you see Make Magazine on this kind of publication right now, it's very very similar. But the big difference now is that we have digital tools to make and to share what we do. So for instance, we have tools to design very easily. So this is an open source software that enables anyone to customize and design your own chair. So you have a common set of principles. So you see there is this curve that you can find in many of the designs. But basically, it's a very easy to use software. So it's pretty much like the same path on all these tools that all the video production software and Photoshop software have followed in the realm of immaterial digital production, but now for physical products. We have tools to make things, and in this the digital fabrication tools are really really key. So moving from bits to atoms, there is a lot of focus on 3D printing and 3D printers because it's maybe the most impressive technology, and like the media loves it, politicians love it, companies love it because it's beautiful, but it should not overshadow the rest of the revolution. And so Neil Gershenfeld from the MIT center of bits of atoms, he said once, like, when I hear the press about 3D printing, it's like reading the press in the 50s about microwaves, basically, because people were saying, okay, microwaves are going to replace the kitchen, all the other tools are not going to be used anymore, and this was completely false. It's one powerful tool in a much broader and more complex ecosystem, and we should not consider 3D printers to be like the one key that will replace everything. So, in digital fabrication, you have, you know, these machines, 3D printers, laser cutters, CNC milling machines, and water jets, and vinyl cutters, and many more of them. But the basic principle is the same. You can turn digital files into physical products, and you can scan them back with a 3D scanner. You have new tools in the field of electronics. So Arduino, you know about it, and Hugo introduced it. It's this fabulous open hardware platform that is enabling so many projects in creative electronics, connected objects, drones, and many other projects. And it's a really essential tool today for makers and entrepreneurs and creative people and students, researchers to make low cost and very effective products. And so you find all these skills and tools in fab labs or maker spaces or tech shops or creative spaces. These are not the same kind of spaces, but because it's not, some are more market oriented, others are more grassroots oriented, others are more research oriented. But there is a common principle, which is a shared space in which you will find the tools, this means of production. So you see almost most of the most essential on this one, which is a fab lab from Iceland. You have the vinyl cutter, the CNC milling machine on one side, the laser cutter, people playing with electronics, and so on. So it's a pretty good picture of what's going on in a typical fab lab. So there are many other kinds of spaces, but fab labs are interesting to look at, especially because there is a very strong network that was coordinated by MIT at the beginning, but which is now coordinated by the Fab Foundation, and there is a very strong incentive to document and share knowledge between these different fab labs in the network, which brings us back to the topic of sharing knowledge, sharing the blueprints, the recipes, whether it's called open design or open hardware. So it can be tutorials, it can be 3D files, how-tos, knowledge on how to use specific process, a machine, and a list, bill of materials, and so on. And you will find platforms such as Thingiverse, Instructables, and others where people will upload their files and share the tutorials to build this kind of of products. You have projects like the RepRap, which I think is a very good illustration of the power of open source hardware. So you know this one. It was created in 2005 by at the University of Bath by Adrian Boyer, and I really love this graphic. It was made by Emmanuel Guillose, who founded the Fab Lab of Nancy, and who now has an open hardware startup called OpenEdge. They distribute open hardware machine tools. And you can see it's like a tree, genealogic tree of the initial RepRap and all the derivatives and the forks that were created between 2005 and 2011. We missed the last 3 years, but I think it's really, really huge, and it could not fit on the screen. But it shows you like how opening one piece of hardware and one invention can unleash a huge amount of potential creativity and products that are really adapted to people and to a specific, like almost one person market, if it's a market. One of them, so this is the one that Emmanuel created. It's pretty famous now. It's the folder app. So it's like a 3D printer that you can fold to take with you when you travel. Another example of great open hardware project or open design, depends on how you want to call it, it's the WikiHow community. So it's a project that was created in like a few years ago by a British architect called Alastair Parvin. Basically, his thought that was you should give to people the means to design, assemble and build by themselves the place where they live, instead of outsourcing that function to urban promoters, urban developers, don't know how you say in English, and construction companies, whose objective is not necessarily to make the most efficient, the most useful and the most livable house, but it's more to basically capitalize on the houses they will sell. So, for instance, in the UK, especially the size of houses have really decreased over time because it was more lucrative for urban developers to do that. And so basically they developed a construction system in which you can generate, it's almost like Lego bricks basically, that you can assemble and CNC with CNC milling machine in any fab lab or maker spaces that has one. And then without any formal training in construction or architecture, you can easily put them together to build the chassis of a house, and then you put the coating and everything that's inside. And I know there is project also in Rennes, which is not exactly the same system, but it's called Libratoire. It's also another open source house. And so I use the term Lego, and I think it's an interesting metaphor, because when you think about open hardware and open design, it's basically like using the components and the parts that are already out there, that were already developed by other people that developed open source hardware products, like we did with software. And it's basically every time you create a new one, you're putting another brick in this big pool, in this bucket of Lego bricks that people can use to build a new stuff. And like the pushing this metaphor really to the extreme, it's like projects such as Open Structures. So Open Structures is a project that was developed by a Belgian designer. It's called Thomas Lomé. He lives in Brussels, but he goes to NC also in Paris to do design courses. And it's basically a design system, a modular design system. So you see the grid on the right. Basically, you have a set of principles, and if you design products according to these principles, you can then basically build anything that is intercompatible between with each other. So, for instance, here it's a set of tables that make up a kitchen equipment. You can build many other types of components, and when you don't need these products, you can just disassemble themselves, reuse the resources and the parts to build new ones. And people that create new parts can just design a new component, a new piece on a CAD software, and then they just upload it on the database, and it's like added to the big pool of Lego that people can just take from to build new modular products. So when we think about this this combination of a global commons of knowledge of open hardware and open design pieces and products, and a local distributed infrastructure of means of production in fab labs, hackerspace, makerspaces, and with all these digital fabrication tools. Well, basically, this is the combination of these two factors that enables what we can call distributed production or distributed fabrication manufacturing. And it's a totally new system that is extremely exciting, because it can open doors to sustainable, on-demand, just-in-time, personalized fabrication. So this is another project that was developed by the architecture studio that developed WikiHouse. It's called OpenDesk. So it's basically a brand and a marketplace that basically coordinates an ecosystem of designers, makers, around the topic of open source furniture. So on this website, you have many designers who can publish their creations. It can be so it's mostly office furniture. So it's chairs, standing desks, armchairs, shelves, whatever. And And you have maker spaces that say, okay, I want to be part of the network. I can make that on demand. And when people go to the website, they can, if they want, just download the file to make it themselves. Or they can say, oh, I don't have the time or the skills, or I don't want to do that right now, or I want to learn maybe with someone. So you can find a local maker to assemble it with this person, or just ask him to make it for you. And so right now in London and New York City, you can even pay online. And your payment is basically divided between the original designer, the maker spaces, and the platform. So it's a very interesting business model. We're going to talk a bit about business model later, but it's really a project that exemplifies the distributed fabrication system. You have similar projects, maybe not specific on furniture, like so SLOD stands for slow design. It's an Italian project that is pretty recent, and it's basically a network that connects local artisans and product designers. So you can have people, local artisans, that will manufacture any kind of design items for customers that want to buy the products of these designers. You start to see platforms like this, BrightHub, or you have also Makers Row or FabHub. It's platforms that try to aggregate the distributed supply chain on a territory. So you can find different suppliers, you can find makers, makerspaces, artisans, and any craftsmen, people with different skills on any types of materials or processes. And the idea is that if you have an idea to develop a new product, you can find all the skills and the tools and suppliers and organizations that can help you to get this project off ground. So it's it can be for the prototyping phase, or it can be for the industrialization phase, if what you want to do is a company and you want to sell your product afterwards. You have on-demand fabrication. So this Sculpteo, you also Shapeways, Ponoco. It's just a platform on which you can send 3D files to get them made on demand. And so they have one main factory in France. But for this kind of website, you can imagine to have local super efficient factories in different regions of the world that could be manufacture and ship locally the products. This is another example. So this one is peer-to-peer. So basically, it's a platform on which people can list their 3D printers, and people can just find somebody to get to have a product made for them, because they don't own a 3D printer, and they don't want to turn to a professional service because it's maybe too expensive, or maybe it's too big a machine, and not like they need something more simple. But then you can find somebody who's in Rennes or in Paris or in Amsterdam or whatever that can make this product for you based on the file. And so maybe the most advanced and inspiring vision for this distributed fabrication concept is what's happening in the city of Barcelona. So in Barcelona in 2007, there was the first Fab Lab of the European Union that opened, the Fab Lab Barcelona. And it was like it's hosted in the Institute of Architecture of Catalonia. And they are working with the municipalities for the last 3 years on what they call the Fab City project. So basically, the idea is to open at least one fabrication space in every neighborhood of the city before 2020. And so it's not only Fab Labs. I mean, you see the Fab Lab logo everywhere here on this picture, but it's not true. Some of them are more independent spaces. They call them Ateneu de Fabricación. If I'm correct, I don't speak Catalan. But it's basically a workshop for prefabrication, where they do a lot of popular education also to teach the people, the citizens, how to use the machines and how to engage with digital fabrication, because it's not easy for people. So in a way, it can remind you of the Espace Public Numérique, if you know, in France, that we're more focused on internet things. And also something that happened in the beginning of the '80s in the UK, which is called Technology Networks. It was set up by the Greater London Council to basically it was state-sponsored hackerspace, and it was shut down by the Thatcher government, as you can imagine. But anyway, it's kind of in this spirit. It's really putting the means of production and the skills in the hands of people, so they can make locally the products and the things and the resources that that they need. And what's at the core of this vision is a concept developed by Neil Gershenfeld, which is moving from a concept of cities that they call PITO. So it's a concept in which cities import standardized products from China or any part of the world. And so you bring product in and you put trash out, basically, because it's the only residual production of the modern cities is to produce trash. And they want to move to what they call DIDO, which stands for data in, data out. You get it. You manufacture most of your needs locally, but you totally exchange open and share open knowledge with any other cities and manufacturing hubs in the world. And in last July, there was the 10th annual Fab Lab conference in Barcelona. And they had the mayor press a button live during the conference that started a countdown for Barcelona to become a self-sufficient city. And what they call the self-sufficient city is basically having the city producing 100% of energy locally, 50% of food locally, and 50% of industrial products locally, which is huge. And so the mayor committed that in the next 40 years, Barcelona will reach this objective and will be a self-sufficient city. You could say that the mayor won't be there in 40 years, so he doesn't risk anything, but that's another problem. But I mean, that's really a very interesting vision because they integrate the Fab City concept into a broader systemic sustainability vision for the city. One question now is like when we talk about makers and distributed fabrication. So these three stages, it was coined by Del Duarte, founder of Make Magazine, and basically says that when you start to make things, you start from scratch because we had to learn again these skills because we forgot them. And then you have the maker to maker, which is when people build tools and products for other makers like Arduino and other things or 3D printers. And then we have the maker to market, which is when makers start to want to build a company, a business, and make a living basically out of what they make. And so the question is now which is key, is like how do you make a living with hardware startups and especially with open hardware? So to reach the markets, I mean the one of the easiest way, I mean maybe not the easiest, but one of them which has been used the most over the past years is crowdfunding and pre-sales, crowdfunding pre-sales. So this is OpenTrance. This is an open source rapid prototyping for biology. So it works pretty much similar to a 3D printer, except that it does not 3D print. It takes biological components and put them into smaller, I mean not smaller, but like in any kind of recipients to do experiments. And so you have many projects like this. And what's interesting is to look at the evolution of the funding on hardware products on Kickstarter. And in 2 years, it was multiplied by 10, between 2011 and 2013. And it's going much faster than the average on all products on the platform. So it's a good indicator that it's also a funding mechanism and an ecosystem that is growing. Then you have platforms like marketplaces like Etsy, which is more for craft products and which enable people to get a market to make a living or make a complementary revenue from the products they made. But then there is the key question of what about business model and entrepreneurship on open hardware itself? Because it's always the key question. Okay, you're giving the knowledge and and the blueprints for free. So how are you not sure that you are not going to get copied, and how can you make a sustainable business model out of it? There is an interesting TED talk from Nathan Seidel, which is the founder of Spark Fun Electronics. It's one of the most successful, if not the most successful, open electronics company. It's in Boulder, Colorado. He said that basically, whether you're open source or not, you're going to get copied anyway, whether it's in China or anywhere else. So you better take advantage of the fact that you're going to to be emulated and get copied and have people interested in what you do. And you're better opening it up from the very start, because you save basically money and it keeps you focused on your on the next big thing, basically on the next product innovation. And they release new products almost every week, and they're super successful because they have a super super strong community. So Making Society, it's a really, really cool blog if you want to develop open hardware projects, and especially if you want to build a startup for it. It was founded by a French girl, Mathilde Berchon. She's been following the space for a while now. And she recently wrote this very cool article that summarized pretty well what are the advantages, basically, of open hardware when you're a startup. It's basically very good for product development, because you rely on other open hardware components, and you get feedback very quickly, and you can build a team and community that will give you feedback and support, and maybe develop derivatives on your project, and you will learn a lot. It's good for marketing and brand, because it's much easier to build a community around a project that is open. And people will talk about it, and will maybe basically do marketing for you also. And also it's very good for your user, because people know they can open the black box. There is no black box, actually, and they can make feedback, and they're happy to have open other products, because they can also tinker with it and invent new things, and they know they're not going to be limited by your products. But the article is much more detailed than that. I invite you to have a look. Maybe before going into detail business models, it's interesting to look at what incumbents, traditional companies and players are doing in the hardware business, because as you can imagine, some of them are quite interested. So the most obvious one are the CAD computer aided design software companies like Autodesk. A few days ago, they just invested in a massive VC fund for 3D printing. It's called Spark. And that's a lot of money. And they launched their own 3D printers too. And they're doing a lot of things in this area. HP just launched a very, like their very first 3D printer with a very advanced technology. Apparently, I'm not an expert on the tech itself, so I couldn't comment, but it seems to be a very advanced 3D printer model. Intel is working a lot with Arduino and on electronics, because they provide chips to make new boards. So they have the Galileo, and they just released a new one, the Intel Edison. So it's based on Arduino, and they try, you can see that they try also to build a community around their product by themselves. General Electric was doing the garages, so it's like mobile maker spaces that they tour in the US, and they're going to do that in Europe next year too, to meet makers and find new ideas for products, basically. Ford partnering with TechShop in Detroit, so they founded the TechShop, and in exchange they got an unlimited membership for their employees to develop new products. And apparently the number of products that made it to the market, or features, really went up after they did this partnership. So it seems to work pretty well. You have DIY retailers like Leroy Merlin, who has opened so L'Atelier is a maker space, like a small maker space in their shop in Angers, and it's so they try to find a business model for it with like training and other things, but from what I heard, it's not working very well. So it's more like people want to come and learn, but they don't really they're not super ready to pay. So it's more like or basically it subsidizes only itself, but they don't hope to make any profit on it. It's more something that builds visibility and that enables them to make to learn more about makers and new practices and how it will affect their industry. 3D printers in La Poste in France, and Auchan, who has been working with Quirky, which is this platform for collaborative product design, and they basically distribute products that were built on the Quirky platform in their retail stores. So, I've been trying to figure out a bit what are the possible business models for open hardware project and company, because the obvious one is, okay, you design a product and you build it and then you sell it. That's surely one, but there may be other options and maybe some small variations on that. So this is a visualization of the Arduino business model, and what's interesting is that like their value proposition. So maybe I don't know if you know this model. It's called the business model canvas. It's a pretty classic strategy making tool for companies or whatever. It helps you basically to visualize how is your business model. So you have customers on the right, on the middle it's the value proposition, what you are actually offering. You see the revenue streams, how are your costs, who are your resources, partners, and so on. And so what's interesting to see that basically at the core of the value proposition of Arduino, sure, you have a cheap and easy to use electronics and that you don't have to build themselves, because if you wanted to make the circuit board, the microcontroller by yourself, it would cost you much more than 20 euros, which is the price it costs today. Also, it's really the support of the community. So since they protect the brand, which is the only piece of intellectual property they protect, like the community basically is super active on the official Arduino platform and on the forum, so you get a lot of new product ideas and support from their own community. And they also have a very much smaller offering that they do for companies like Intel or others that want to make Arduino-based products and derivatives. And in terms of revenue streams, so they sell directly their products online, through the Arduino store. They also sell it through their partner, and the partner are actually the manufacturing partner. And what is very interesting and important to understand is that Arduino actually does not manufacture themselves their Arduino boards. They outsource the manufacturing itself to three companies. You have Smart Projects, which is based in Italy as well, hence the Made in Italy, who does most of the board. And you have two other companies. One is SparkFun that we talked about, and the other is Gravitech, and they do very specific model, like the Arduino Pro for instance, and these ones are made in the US. But so the core skills and business of Arduino is really the product design, product innovation, product prototyping. So they have a maker space where they prototype the products. And it's the community management, but it's not the manufacturing itself. The manufacturing, it's a partner they are very close with, but it's not their own factories. And I think it's very important to understand that. And on the other side, SparkFun, because SparkFun, it's the opposite. The core capabilities of SparkFun is to be super efficient to build a lot of open hardware products. So SparkFun, they sell products they designed. They sell products they assembled but did not design, like the Arduino Pro, and they sell products that were designed and made by a third party. So for instance, they distribute the very classic Arduino Uno, But this one is like they didn't even made themselves, since they are made in Italy by Smart Projects. And so it's very important to understand that even though both of these companies, Arduino and SparkFun, distribute open hardware electronics, their business model is not exactly the same. There's a recouvrement, I don't know, an overlap in some of what they do, but it's not the same skills exactly. And SparkFun actually has much more employees. It's like almost 150, and Arduino it's 40 employees. So this is another interesting example of how this industrial efficiency can be important in open hardware. So Open Source Ecology, it's a project that developed 50 industrial machines for agriculture and local resilience. And with these 50 machines, open source machine, you can basically rebuild a civilization from scratch. So they have this kind of DVD with all the files, and it's like they call it a civilization starter kit. Like with that, you can basically restart a society from scratch. So you have the tractor, the bread oven, the I don't know how you say béton, but something to do béton, and so on. And so like they were founded at the beginning with the foundation, but now they're how they sustain themselves. They have some donations, but also they sell products that they made, and they became extremely performant and ultra efficient in manufacturing their own machines because they are modular, because they use agile manufacturing techniques and so on. And when you look at the production cost of one tractor and you compare it to the retail price of the equivalent on the market, you see there is a big difference of factor 5 basically. And they do that while being able to build a tractor in 1 day today. I think maybe they're not there yet, but they aim to build every machine in only 1 day with a team of 8-9 people. So they have like a huge I would say a margin, because they have a very super important productivity. So they're able to sell very robust, durable products for a fraction of the price of the retail market, but while still making a very decent lifestyle, because they can achieve a very, very high productivity. So that is the business model they're developing at the moment. Maybe a word on what we could call partially open products. This obviously makes some debate in the open hardware community. And the core of that is a CC BY, a non-commercial license. So I didn't make any specific focus on the licenses because I'm maybe not the expert, and it's a bit a technical topic. But basically, you have several licenses from Open Hardware: the TAPR license, the CERN license, and some people use Creative Commons to basically put the blueprints and the 3D files in Creative Commons. And so this is a project called XYZ Cargo. It's like modular bikes or cargo bikes, and like all the blueprints are in a Creative Commons standard, except the small joint. So the small black thing that you see on the right, it's a specific thing they invented to assemble very easily the different parts to make up a cargo bike. And this one is in CC BY non-commercial, which means you can make it yourself, but you cannot sell it. They're only the agency. It's a Danish agency that can sell them. So is it really open source? I don't know. Does it matter? I don't know, but I mean, it's interesting to mention this. Two examples. I apologize for the text because it's extracted from another presentation that is actually read. But so some projects make a living by providing something else than just the product, something immaterial. Like Tripalium, it's a collective in the south of France that builds that share knowledge in French about auto-construction of wind turbines, and they organize seminars for people to build their own wind turbines. So you have a group of people who come, and they all pay to learn how to build a wind turbine. And one of them pays a higher fee, so they get back the wind turbine in the end. They pay two people like that, and they make money only by doing this kind of workshops and classes. And in the case of Wikispeed, which is this super efficient open source car, the Wikispeed consumers, basically, they don't only buy a car, they also buy the experience of building it themselves, because they pay upfront, and so they spend time with the Wikispeed teams to know and understand how the car is made, and they can contribute and participate to the building workshops. And they also do consulting with Boeing or John Deere or this kind of industrial companies, because they have super efficient agile processes. Actually, they were the ones who taught open source ecology how to manufacture with agile techniques. Another approach, which is not again technically open source because they are not licensed. It's like Tesla. Okay, we release our patents for good faith use. What does it mean? I don't know. But anyway, the point is that they don't do that only by philanthropy and only because they want to have electric vehicles everywhere. They also do that because that opens a new market. So the strategy is like you open your patents, and by doing that, you push a standard on the industry, and then the industry basically has a little other choice than to adopt your standard because it's super efficient. And you can see on the right the plans for Tesla charging stations for the batteries that are adapted to that standard between now and the end of next year. And so basically, they have another business line, which is selling batteries and selling services of charging stations. One last interesting model is the model of the platform, aggregator of ecosystem. So I talked a bit about it during the example of OpenDesk. So this is a slide from a friend of mine, Simone Cicero, who was working on open source vehicle. He called that participative value chains. And so open source vehicle is another project of open source car that is developed by an Italian-Chinese team. And so they develop the chassis and the motor of the Tabby, and they develop the urban Tabby, which is the same but with a small habitacle around it. And so they try to basically, around the open source vehicle platform, to aggregate a network of many people. So they have partners who do vehicle designs, people who do connected objects, software platforms, and so on. And they have one mode of production that they call the DIT mode. It's for 1,000 markets, 1,000 series of 1,000 vehicles. And they work with startup designers. I mean, they want to work because it's still pretty new with startups, designers, brands, cities, and so on. And so these are basically the three market they have: DIT, so it's with an ecosystem, and they build special new vehicles. The ecosystem is for customized modules, so it's more 100. And DIY is really like if you want to totally hack the vehicle and build yours that is totally custom, you can do it. If this concept of platforms and participative evaluation is interesting to you, so this is my friend Simone, and he basically developed this methodology that he called the Platform Design Toolkit, that is a way to analyze your ecosystem and how you can create value by at the interaction of the different stakeholders of the platform. Another announcement is so all the different business models on open hardware I just described, they are described in a chapter I wrote in a book in French that is coming out very soon. It's called Open Models. It was coordinated by Louis-David Benayer from a think tank called Without Model, which is a think tank about innovative business models. And it's like a book about every business models for the open economy. So you have hardware, culture, science, and so on. So if you're interested, you can have a look on the website. Last part before starting with the questions, I'm a bit late, I'll try to not be too long. maybe three reasons why, according to me, open source hardware is important. Hugues mentioned a very very important ones about also cities and smart cities. We'll get back to that. I think one, obviously, is has to do with robots. So this comes from a concert of Kraftwerk I was at a few days ago. That was really cool, if you know it. But I saw these two numbers in an article newspaper recently, and it really scared me. One is a number from a study from the University of Oxford that said that basically, in the next 20 years, half of the current jobs will disappear due to automation. And the other is that you have now 85 people who have as much wealth as the poorest half of the world. So when you took these two numbers together, you can have a very dark dystopian scenario for the future. And I also saw that this week. So it's the Amazon picking challenge. So it's like an open competition for people that want to design robots that will replace the workers in the factories of Amazon to pick up the parcels. So you can just start to understand the size and the importance of all this automation trend will have. So we have in France very cool open source robot project, and I'm not going to talk in detail because you're going to have a presentation about them today, and I think you will saw them this afternoon. So RoboUp, it's a project from the Mad Lab in Manchester, and they try to hack existing industrial robots by developing interfaces and new programming languages that are open source and that you can play with, because the original ones are totally closed. So they managed to hack one typical industrial robot, and they are not trying to work with new ones. And so I think like this whole, basically, I mean, we've seen that before. It all comes down to the who owns the means of production, you know, like the robots, who will own them. And I was stunned to see this this quote from Adrian Boyer, so the inventor of RepRap. So this is from a paper of 2004 before the RepRap was out, and basically he says he quotes actually Marx in the paper, and he sees the RepRap as a way for the proletariat to own the means of production. So there was a pretty radical political vision in the RepRap project itself, and I think this means of production ownership in open hardware is really important given the automation trend. Another one which was touched on by Hugues is the connected object, Internet of Things. This is another powerful article on TechCrunch, pretty recent. It's called The Internet of Someone Else's Thing. I love this title. And it's basically a warning that, you know, like all these products that look cool because they give you data about yourself, quantify self, or they monitor your home or whatever. Well, basically, you don't really own the product anymore, because somebody can take access from a distance and change it or cut it or whatever. You all remember the story about the Kindle on which there was a 1995 which was removed by Amazon. And so there is also this very good talk that I recommend from Bruce Sterling at FAB10. So Bruce Sterling is a science fiction author, very critical of some parts of technology. So he has a very powerful talk where he talks about smart city states and how exactly what Hugues was saying, that how cities are basically abandoning the control over sensors and smart city system to a lot of industrial technological companies. And I think it's important to oppose to that the vision of the smart citizen. And smart citizen, it's a project that is a bit similar to the one that Hugues presented. This one is from Barcelona, and it's a small sensor that monitor environmental data. So it's a temperature, air pollution, noise, or whatever. And it aggregates all that in an open source dashboard So the hardware and the software are open source, where cities can look at the or citizens can look at the environmental data, but from the perspective of citizens, because it's the people who put these sensors at home or who go out with them or whatever. Maybe the last part, and I'm going to conclude on that. I don't need to remind you that we live in difficult times, and we face the most pressing challenges of our history. So sustainability, climate, the resource crisis. And I think that open hardware can play, open source generally and open hardware in particular, can play a key role in addressing these challenges because of the diffusion and dissemination and replication effects of these technologies. So a few examples. An interesting open hardware project that tried to tackle the question of recycling and resources. It's called Perpetual. Not perpetual plastic. This one is called precious plastic, and it's a Dutch designer, the same guy that did Phone Block, the modular telephone, if you know this. And so he published 4 open hardware machines to shred or extrude or basically build new plastic products out of recycled plastic. And I think it's a pretty interesting prototype. He's trying to do it to have a good enough thread to put it into 3D printers as well. But the machines are other ways to do it. Other example is what's happening. So in the mountains near Barcelona, it's the Valdora self-sufficient lab. So it's a fab lab that is only about self-sufficiency and resource efficiency. So they build these open source beehives with sensors to monitor the health of the bees. On the right, you have the cardboard thing. It's a structure in which they grow mushrooms to do bio architecture. They do bio solar photovoltaic panels as well. Open source ecology, I mentioned that, and Wikispeed as well. And so I want to finish. So I'm working on a project that is called POC21. So it stands for proof of concept. It's also the reverse of COP21, which is COP21, which is a climate conference that is going to be next December in Paris. And the idea is to build an accelerator for open source hardware sustainability. So this is a place we got from a philanthropist who lives 40 minutes from Paris. It's a big place, and he basically wants to have cool projects in this area. And it will unfold in 3 phases. First part of research, a second part that is about having 50 people, 12 projects, living and working together during 5 weeks in this area to prototype a solution on energy, construction, waste treatment, agriculture, whatever. And then we want to reach out to mainstream media, academia, policymakers, investors, companies to support all of this product and project, and to basically give out the message that open source is a serious asset that should be considered to tackle the biggest issues of our century. And this is like something we want to do, is to do some sort of a catalog that puts it in a more user-friendly way. So like something like an hybrid between IKEA and the whole Earth, the whole Earth catalog. So if you're interested, we have a website that is going to be up soon, POC20.cc, and you can find the slides if you look on SlideShare that explain more in detail the project. And I'm done. Thank you very much.
Any question? No? No question.
Did I put you to sleep?
No, I don't think so. No, I don't think
so. Maybe you have a question, Stefan.
No, I didn't thought of it. UX is not there. No. I'm very impressed. For me, I know we have been with Adrian Boyer, who came for and as well Wikispeed and so on. But I didn't know, the thing is we didn't know the roads because it's a long time they came. So Adrian Boyer came in 2006, Wikispeed came as well, Wikihouse and so on. But we didn't know the adventure today. So I was very pleased to see how big they are today.
Yeah.
Ah, Chris.
Well, I had lots to say, so I just couldn't think. So I was at a at a lecture recently in London, and one of the very eminent professors told us that he thought that open source was just ideological, that it was crazy talk, we were just extremists and this thing would never take off. But as I'm listening to you talk, I see this is going to happen. I mean, it is happening. It's already here. We just haven't really got the message out. Could you say a little bit more about, first of all, the notion that this is just an ideological movement, that it's just crazy, it's never going to work? And also, I'd love to hear you speak a little bit more about the WikiHouse project, because, you know, this is a much needed innovation. No?
Yeah. So I think it's... I think it's a movement. I think like free software and open source software. I think it started also maybe as an ideological movement for some people, but also you always have this this duality between free software, which is really about the ideology and the movement and the freedom, and the open source, which is more about it's the right thing to do, it's efficient, it's better, it works better this way, more rational. And I think you can find the same two philosophies in open source hardware. Some people talk about free hardware also, like free software, matériel libre en français. And it's still pretty young compared to software, but it's been like almost 10 years for some project. Like Arduino was founded in 2006, and it's one of the key enablers for a lot of projects. I think we're going to see more and more on those. I think we start to understand that some projects can be self-sustainable. For others, it will be more difficult. I think we'll see also foundations like in free software emerging. So it's still extremely young, but WikiHouse, for instance, is trying to establish a WikiHouse foundation. And the idea is that to aggregate around this foundation partners, so builders, developers, and any companies that have or companies that make connected home products, smart things, etc., and to have some sort of an ecosystem of players that can build and sell WikiHouse products if they want, while the foundation is more like the institution that will manage the knowledge, the technology, and the community, but we stay a non-profit independent. So it's still very early, but they try to do that. You also have the Linux Foundation, who tries to do derivatives like they have a thing called AllSyn Alliance. It's an open source platform for Internet of Things. And drone code is for drones as well. So it's still on the software, not really the hardware, but the Linux Foundation also tries to look into hardware products, which is interesting. And regarding the WikiHouse project, what do you want to know exactly? Because
right. So are you familiar with Hexera, which is Vinay Gupta's project? So it's a house made out of cardboard, but then on the outside it's made of tin, like tin foil. And what's beautiful about this is you can buy it for about $500 to $1,000, and this is for someone to make it for you. And even if one of the slabs of cardboard gets, water inside of it, you just pull it out and put another one in. And what's lovely is you don't have to be an engineer. Anyone can do that.
Yeah.
And so I just wondered if you could talk a little bit about why isn't this becoming more prevalent? In the UK, for example, to put one of these things up, you can't go anywhere near a built-up area because the local authority won't let you put a structure that looks that ugly on the ground. You've got to go through a central point of failure. Yeah. So are these things feasible, or how long until we start seeing more of these?
Yeah, it is feasible, but that's the key issue, like the land and discourse and what the Alastair talks about is really about this right to build. Which I think is in the constitution in the UK or something. Like, there is something in the regulation about the right to build, but basically...
Yeah, but you've still got to go through a parish committee, all of whom have special interests because they are landowners on this territory as well. Yeah. And so they're actually protecting their own... We can't, in other words, we can't open source the land, can we?
So what? I mean, but it's really, yeah, that's the biggest issue. You know, when you have like what Karl Polanyi said, like we need to decommoditize labor, money, and land. Okay, labor is possible. Money is difficult, but we have currencies. Land is definitely the most difficult of them. I think there are some possibilities. I met a guy in the UK who's working on community land trust. So I don't know very well about them, but maybe that could be something to look into. But yeah, I don't have the answer to that, but that's, yeah, the land is always the most difficult thing.
Very good. Thank you very much. Great talk.